Welcome to Faith That Works, exploring the changed lives of those living by faith. Your host, Bob McHouston, will spotlight ordinary people who have discovered for themselves a faith that works.
Thank you. We welcome you again to another program of Faith That Works. I want to thank you for watching. I so appreciate you tuning into the program. And we would love to say thank you. And one of the ways we would like to say thank you is to send you our little booklet on the new birth. Booklet I've written a couple of years ago, probably. We would love to send you this booklet as a thank you card just for watching the program. So if you'll call the number on the screen and leave your name and mailing address, we'll send you that, put that booklet in the mail. We don't keep a mailing list or a calling list. We don't even have caller ID. So if you'll just call and leave your name and mailing address, we would love to send you this booklet just to say thank you for watching the program. We really do appreciate you watching. I have a special guest, two special guests tonight or today or whatever time you're watching the program. John Sparks and Rex Harsin. And I'm going to let them introduce themselves. They can tell you about themselves better than I can. So just so the folks will know who you are and where you're coming from, just sort of give us a little background about yourself, John. We'll start with you. You live in where?
Oregon.
In Oregon. I know you talk kind of funny.
Yes.
Yeah. you lived in India?
Yes. My wife and I, we lived in India for 10 years. In the northern part of India. India is a country of many different nations, many different people groups. Mm. And so many years back, God put a burden on my heart. Jesus said, go and make disciples of all nations. And so within India, there's more than 1,600 languages, more than 4,000 different ethnic groups. And so for us to be obedient, I felt that this is where we needed to go, and so God put that burden for India on my heart 20 years back. And so we spent 10 years there in India, and after that time, God gave us a call to help direct this ministry that is working with indigenous ministries there in India that are helping the people that are marginalized, people who are oppressed, especially people who are what they call extremely impoverished. Mm-hmm. And so people that live on less than $1.50 a day just don't have the wherewithal to educate their children, the ability to escape the things that poverty entraps you in. And so we work with those people.
Now, is this the same area of people where they have the different levels of, you know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah,
got
so
the little dot under.
Casteism.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Very prevalent in India. You know, depending on where you live, it's less prevalent in the city, more prevalent out in the village and day-to-day life. But the important parts of life are oftentimes ruled by the caste that you're born into. So in marriage is oftentimes based on caste. Your ability to get higher education is oftentimes based on caste. And the job
caste,
that you work.
Meaning the level of?
Yes, the level that you're born into.
Mm-hmm. As far as financially or?
No, as far as your parents, it's a very spiritual thing. Hmm. And so the highest caste are the priests, and then it goes down, and it's a spiritual level that you're born into.
Okay.
And so if you're born into the lowest levels of the spiritual caste, it's based on the fact that you had sinned in your previous life, and so therefore you were born into a lower level, and you pay for those sins in this life, in the job that you have, and things like this.
So is this a huge hindrance for you to in your ministry there to the folks in India?
It's in some ways you might think of it, it's also opportunity. Mm. Because if you understand a person's caste, you understand how they think, how they relate to other people, and so Christ's message can be shared with people, whatever caste they're in.
Mm-hmm.
Someone who is in the upper castes of Hinduism, they don't seem to think they need it as much because they've already have a relationship with God in their own mind. And so if you think you've arrived, you don't think you need anything. And so in that sense, they feel sufficiency.
Mm-hmm.
But as you talk with them, as you share with them, the eternal nature of God will put that upon their hearts as well.
It's amazing, John, to me, how God will put a country on somebody's heart with all the needs all over the world, yet he'll put India on your heart. He put Cuba on my heart. He'll put Philippines on somebody else. That's just amazing to me.
It's thrilling. I mean, the first time I went to India, I had visited maybe 40 countries before I went to India.
Really?
And I came back home and I went to my parents and I said, will you give me up for India? It was God just said, this is the right place. And so I don't want to pick on Rex. I don't want to put him on the spot.
Go
but
ahead.
He'll say
put him on
that
the spot.
He went to India. He's traveled to other countries, been to other places. But India, for some reason, God just laid that. I think it's Acts 17:34. It says God has a time and a place for every people.
Mm-hmm.
And so sometimes our life intercedes with God's plan. And when they come together, it just there's this peace in the midst of chaos.
Mm-hmm.
And so you say, this is a very interesting. How am I going to deal with this now?
So how are you going to put Rex on the spot?
He'd been in a number of countries, and then he came to India last month.
Just last
for
month.
The first time. Mm-hmm. And came away severely touched, maybe shaken. I don't know the right word, his life.
What would be the right word? Why did you go to India to start with, Rex?
Okay.
What do you do?
I'm a filmmaker and a photographer.
Okay.
And my hope and my goal, and what I believe is the hope and goal of my family, is to partner with other groups like India Partners, we offer our services filmmaking wise and photography wise to help them tell their story, to help to tell the world what they do. So that's our goal. So we come alongside and we help, and we don't ask for reimbursement. We even raise our own funds for the trip.
Mm-hmm.
So I learned about India Partners through AFR, and I was just immediately moved. And I talked to my wife about it, and she was immediately moved, and it just sort of broke our heart, the stories that we were hearing.
And so, what were those stories like, for example?
Like, primarily it was the stories about the children living in the red light district, you know, the children of the sex workers there. And we just wanted to get involved. Mm-hmm. So I called. Mm-hmm. I just made a phone call and I called India Partners and I said, this is who I am. This is what I do. This is what's on my heart. I want to help. I want to be involved. So about a year later, when the opportunity came up, John, they called me up and they said, you know, are you ready to go? And we had about 2 or 3 months advance, you know, warning to raise the funds and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And so we went. And the word that I would say is, there's not one, shaken, overwhelmed, but I would say that what it really did was there was already a kindling fire in my heart
for
it is for India, but it's also for this work.
Okay.
For the work that we did over there and the partnering and the telling of the stories.
Mm-hmm.
But the it kindled and it really struck up the fire to do more, to be in the field, you know, to go out into the field and tell the stories of the missionaries and the groups that are out there, you know, doing what they do. Because seeing what India Partners does is they do amazing work. I mean, because we got to see where the people that they help, we get to see where they come from, and we get to see the relief that's offered, and we get to see where they get to come to because of this good work that's going on. So the more that we're able to tell that story, mm-hmm. our hope is the more we're going to be able to come alongside them and help them do more. That's what, as a filmmaker and a photographer, I want to do. I want to help them tell their stories so that they can do more, so they can get more help back home, so they can touch more hearts and get more people involved.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because when you put visuals with what people are, they might read it, they might hear it, but then you show it to them,
mm-hmm.
and hopefully that pricks their heart to want to do more.
So you talk about the red light district, the sex slavery or whatever you call it. Is this where y'all are focused on mostly, or is
it's one of the areas of ministry?
Okay.
But human trafficking, India has about 20 million people that have been trafficked, and some of them into the sex trade. Not all of them, but into the sex trade. And so because there's a lot of diverse languages, someone who's in this business will take a woman from one part of the country and move her to the other side of the country, and she doesn't speak the language, she doesn't have the family ties, she doesn't have an ability to escape from her captor. And so through drugs and oppression and rape, they trap this woman into this work. And so then they take the profits away from them, give them enough to live on, but then they trap them in that work until they can't leave. There's no ability to get out of it.
So it's not just sex trafficking, it's for...
We're primarily, we work in the area of women who've been trafficked.
Mm-hmm.
But they will, it's wider than that. They bring them in and have them do
workers.
Labor in the fields, labor in the construction industry, making bricks. You know, ancient Israel, they were mm. in Egypt making bricks. The same work goes on today in India by, again, people who've been trafficked into that work.
That kind of thing, to some degree, is happening in our country. Not necessarily the labor part, but the sexual part. But it's so foreign to so many of us to see this as just a way of life.
It's interesting. It's foreign to the most people in India as well.
Really?
Yeah. So you don't, if you walk into that part of the city where it's taking place, until you make that turn onto that street, you don't know it's there. Mm-hmm. It isn't like there's a big sign or something that says, mm-hmm. you know, only people over 21 years old. It's you know, right in there at the rest of the city. So you don't know it's there until you walk onto that street.
What age are these girls about, generally average-wise, that's trafficked in?
I was at a shelter one time, and a girl who had been, hadn't been taken all the way to the city, but had been taken for that purpose, was 6 years old.
No.
Yeah. And so they start very young.
Mm-hmm.
We try to get the children out by the age of six.
Now, are these kids kidnapped, or are they sold by their parents, or
sometimes what will happen is a girl child in India, especially in a rural area, is seen as a real drain on the family's finances. They're not seen as valuable. When they eventually grow up and they get married, they leave the family. And so they don't like to make investment in them for anything because they're going to go away. And so they're not valued.
Mm.
And so what will happen is you'll have a trafficker will come to a village and he says, you know, I need somebody who can come to the big city, and they'll work in the home, and they'll wash dishes, and they'll sweep the floor, and they'll take care of the infants. And so they only have to be, you know, 7 or 8 years old to be able to do these things. So they say, oh, my daughter could go. And he says, I will give you, you know, $100, and then I'll send you some money each month as part of her wages. And so they say, okay, this burden is going to become a resource for me. And plus my daughter will get food and shelter, and she'll have a better life than have in the village. And so they think a good thing for their daughter and a good thing for themselves. They say, okay, we will do this. Well, the person actually just takes this girl and takes her to the city and puts her in the sex trade.
That's the last appearance ever here from.
It's the last ever. It's, I mean, she's the other side. The girl that we met that had been trafficked didn't know the name of her village, didn't speak the local language. And so there was no hope for ever connecting her back with her family. And that's, they're able to use that system and to trap these girls into slavery.
So what do you do with these kids when you rescue them?
Primarily what we do is we go into this area, the red light district, and we minister to the women that are working. It's a strange experience that I had, but to go into the red light district and have a church service. Worship the Lord with a group of women who are all in the sex work.
Mm.
But after they come to know the Lord.
Did you film any of that? Were you able to film in some of that?
He was there on a day that we did not get to see that aspect of the
okay.
ministry. But Anne, one of the other people who've gone with us there have experienced that and seen this situation where these women who have been trafficked are there. And so after you come to know the Lord, you don't want your children to even stay in this red light district anymore. You want them out.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's we'll take these children, we'll put them in a home that's not, it's in the same city as their mother, so she can come and visit, but there's not a direct contact. So the child ends up going to English medium school, getting all her education in English, getting excellent skills, learning all about the Bible. These children pray better than I do,
mm-hmm.
and so it's just amazing what God has done in their life. And so oftentimes their desire is to, as they grow up, is to serve the Lord and to be able to help others. Many of the girls, you ask them what they want to do, and they say, I want to be a teacher when I grow up.
Mm-hmm.
And so they want to replicate the life that they see in the people that are raising them,
mm-hmm.
so that they too can be people of change.
Rooks, from what you saw firsthand, what did it do to you?
Okay, I didn't get to experience a worship service in Mumbai. And Mumbai is the largest city in India. And we're talking, we were in the slums. I mean, it's just like you go in the back and it's like a maze of just, it's hard to be there.
Yeah.
And the things that you see, I mean, people living in tiny rooms. And there was one of the ladies, one of the sex workers there that they had, I guess she wasn't able to have children, I don't know, but the man that she was living with wanted to have a child, and she couldn't. I'm interpreting this from a different language. I'm able to put this together. But they had found this infant baby in the trash.
Mm.
And she took it. And it was in the room when we came in. And she was trying to raise the child. And she was trying to nurse the child. And she was trying to bring the child essentially back to life, because
mm-hmm.
the child had been in the literally in the trash, like in a trash can. And we're talking an infant, like maybe a couple of weeks old. And I mean, it was malnourished, it was sunken in, I mean, it looked deformed.
So this had just happened, she had just gotten the baby.
Yeah, and in that moment, like in the darkest place we went, I mean, the darkest place, and it was, I mean, it was the last day that I was there, and we're getting film and we're getting video of all this. And in the darkest place I've ever been, I felt the love and the power of God so strong in that room,
mm-hmm.
because I just felt the Spirit reminding me that what this woman, what this sex worker, someone who probably most people on the planet would just disregard,
mm-hmm.
what this woman was doing is what God does for us.
Mm-hmm. Reach in the trash and get us.
He picks us up out of there when we are dying and we have been disposed of by the world. And he brings us back to health. And I can't explain it. It's like I felt the love and his power. And it was so strong. And that wasn't the only time that happened on the trip. I mean, there were a lot of powerful encounters. But that was the one that just put me on. Mm-hmm. I mean, just put, I didn't even know, I didn't know what to do with myself. It was so strong.
He lifts us up out of a horrible pit. And he sets our feet on solid ground. And he puts a new song in our heart. And that's, you saw that picture happening, humanly speaking. And that's what God has, that's a good picture.
Yeah.
Of what God has done and is doing for us. Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about how, were you raised in a Christian home, John? Were your parents missionaries or?
I was raised in a very missional home. My parents were church-going Christians like most. But I had aunts and uncles who served on the mission field in places like Korea. I have a number of cousins who are in different places around the world serving mm-hmm. in the mission field. And my grandfather was a traveling evangelist back during the 50s and 60s. Mm-hmm. And so it was part of who we are as Christians, missions was.
So you were born again at an early age?
I would say I had a lot of Christian experience.
Yeah.
As a child, I went through the church, good with memory verses and singing the old hymns. But it was about the age of 30 when God sort of, I would say, hit me upside the head with a 2x4
mm-hmm.
and said, enough. Time to get to work.
Enough playing church, you're talking about? Or
yeah, enough, you know, going to church and paying my tithes
yeah.
was not Christian.
Yeah.
It was time to get to work. And so yeah.
I wonder if that person sitting on that couch right now, did you hear that? I wonder how many times God's spoken to you, and now tonight he's yelling at you, it's about time to get to work. It's about time to get real. I believe God's going to hit you upside the head with a 2x4 just like you did, John.
Yeah, I think it's smarter to go along willingly. The 2x4 is not a pleasant experience.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's Ephesians 2:10 says we're God's creation.
Yeah.
Created in God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works.
Yeah.
And so he says, I've got all these good works that I've prepared for you to do. And all you're doing is playing this race, the human race stuff, and
yeah.
it's not what you're
just creating playing
for.
Church.
Yeah, and so it meant to get out of the pew and get to doing what he had for me, and took me to India.
Yeah,
and sort of said this is the place, and it's very different than here, but like what Rex was saying, you get to see God at work.
Mm-hmm.
And miraculous and exciting ways mm-hmm. That I think you can also see it here in America, but you got to get in those sometimes those crazy places to be
mm-hmm.
able to see it.
Mm-hmm. I know that some of the listeners, viewers tonight are where you were at one time, John. Good, moral, church going. Christian people, but just sort of playing church, just sort of satisfied with just church. And I'm telling you, after being in Israel last year, seeing a little of what Jesus experienced every day of his life from the religious Jews who hated him, and he had to deal with that every day. We only had to deal with it for 2 weeks. Cursing and rejection and all this stuff, and he dealt with it every day of his life. Not even counting the cross. But and then I come back home, and I just can't be satisfied in just another church, in just another street corner. Nice church with nice people doing nice things, but somehow I think Jesus is lost in all of this other stuff. Church. I think church has hidden Jesus from a lot of people. I don't know if that makes sense to some people, but I think there's somebody watching that's been hidden from Christ by your church. Just doing church. If you just do church, if you can just do some more church, and somehow you just miss Jesus altogether. That emptiness is still there. That longing for something meaningful is still there. And you don't know what it is. Well, I think maybe God wants to speak to you like he spoke to John at age 30 years old and say, it's time for you to listen to me. It's time for you to baby. Now listen, folks, I want to make clear, we're not talking about working your way to heaven. We're not talking about being good so you can go to heaven. We're talking about knowing Jesus and the result of that created for good works. Be sure, John, I think so much in this country, we got that all backwards, and we think good works is going to get us to heaven. But listen, it's not by your works which you've done, but by grace through faith, so that you can't boast about it. It's a gift of God. So I want to ask you, folks, are you ready to get off the couch and listen to God and then obey him? Are you willing to listen to him? Just this morning, I was out on the deck spending some time with the Lord. I didn't even take my Bible. I said, God, I just want to have some fellowship with you. And in the process, I said, God, I just want to obey you. And I want to have fellowship with you. And it just came to me. Get so focused on obedience and somehow miss out on that fellowship. Doing what you know God wants you to do. And you're busy doing that, but somehow you're missing out on the fellowship. You can obey without fellowship, but you can't fellowship without obeying. So I pray that you'll begin to hunger and you'll respond to that stirring that God is stirring inside of you right now. And you'll respond to that. God say, yes, whatever it takes, here I am. Will you use me? What a glorious privilege it would be. Can you imagine that God would use somebody like me, somebody like you? Oh, listen, if you'll just be available, that's all he wants. Would you just tell him right now that you're available? God, here I am. Will you just do whatever you want to with me? Whatever it takes, will you just do whatever you want to with me? And some of you need to meet the Lord Jesus because you've had church all your life, but you've never experienced a new birth. That change that comes when the Lord Jesus comes live in you. Do you know him? I mean, do you know him? Are you fellowshipping with him? Do you have a relationship with the risen Christ? Not just religion, but a relationship with the risen, resurrected Christ. If you do, you know what I'm talking about. If you don't, you know there's something still missing in your life. Will you give your heart to him tonight? Would you receive Jesus into your life? Would you let him come into your life, take over control of your life? You know why? Because he loves you. He loves you supremely.